All right. So we're live. Thank you, everyone, for taking the time to listen. Going to go through a couple of things today. First off, on the docket is day 66 of my 100 push-ups, 100 sit-ups every day. So I'm going to kind of just go through a couple of the edits that I've done, talk about the progress, and invite you to try as well. Then the main meat of today's stream is to talk about 10 human movements that are going extinct. So that's something that I'm really excited about talking about because it leads into a bigger idea that I hope to present a couple weeks or months from now that I'm really trying to think about and process. And then it also ties into with the third component is the ARG. I want to talk just for a second about an ARG and bring that into a conversation with whoever's listening, if anyone's listening. If not, it's just me also taking time to process this. I would love to know if the lights in the background are a little too much. In our home, we have lots of like gadgets and doodads and stuff being performers. So I end up finding my wife's material. So I'm using these lights. I was like, why not? You know, like if we have the lights, then should use them. Okay, so let's do going to the, I'm going to let a couple play for a second. So this is. So that was day 58 59. So a part of this is that some days I might be a little too tired, so I won't even get all the way through. Like I might have a really hard Friday and be so tired that I'm like, I can't do the 100. So I'll kind of just tack it on to Saturday. And then Saturday I'll do 200 pushups, 200 sit-ups. So I just want to encourage you that if there's a day or a couple of days that you're feeling kind of tired and not physically capable, motivated, whatever it is, then just know that there's that possibility to add it on. And one of my students, he has like a couple days where he's like just trying to catch up, and it's like, all right, well, I'm just going to keep a log of how many I actually owe. So that's a cool idea. And that's where I got day 58 and day 59. Let's fix this. That way it's a little bit bigger. So let's do just a few more days. So I'm going to go the next day if it'll let me. So I don't know why it doesn't want to. That's up. Go up. The heck? No, I do. All right. Let me just jump ahead to day. Let's go to this one. So that's fun. That was day 64 and 65. Another 200. So that's day 66. It's coming along, so I hope you kind of jump into it on your own and get started. Like I said, I'm going to be doing this for a while. So to the next chunk of what I wanted to talk about, I'll share this tab instead, so that should pop up. Okay, so I remember hearing about this a couple years ago, and it was talking about 10 human movements that are going extinct. And I thought I would kind of just talk about each one of these and give my thoughts about it. And just as like a commentary on how we as a people are physically losing a lot in the world. This is from MoveNet on the top right. And it says, sorry, I'm just playing around with this. I see a world coming where walking will become just a notion, a skill of the past. A world where people will have to learn how to walk again. New quote, I guess, Erwan Le Corre. And then, do you think that could ever happen? Could never happen? You're not convinced that natural human movement is going extinct. Ask yourself, how many of these timeless yet rapidly disappearing movements have you performed this week, this month, this year? So let's just make sure I'm still there. Okay, cool. So I like this because it's just a way of thinking about your movement and having a little bit more awareness of like your expression and how expressive are you during your day. You know, I tend to think that a lot of our time is spent in the sagittal plane. So just moving forwards and backwards like this. And especially when we're typing on our phone or texting on our phone or we're typing on the computer. So that leads us into the first one, which is sitting without a chair. So I think the chair is like really awesome technology, but this goes to like sitting in the bottom of a squat. And how often are you during the day going to the bottom of a squat and taking time to hang out down there and let your hips breathe? I remember hearing this one guy, I'll send a link on the description, but it's called Human Garage. And this guy was talking about how just in a sitting, which is okay, our pelvic floor, when we breathe through the diaphragm, it doesn't have space to go downward when we sit in a chair. We have the chair that gives it feedback and kind of shortens the range of motion that our breath can go. So the breath starts to get caught up in the top of the neck at the clavicles. And so we breathe all the way up here, but we're not breathing all the way through. So even that, our hips start to get tight because we're just sitting most of the time. And I guess, you know, that brings me to standing and the desk, standing desk, which is cool. But I think I recommend to a lot of my students to set a timer for at least once or twice a day. Ideally, it would be once an hour if you're just beginning, that you go down to the bottom of the squat and you take some time there and let your hips breathe, let your ankles breathe, let your spine find a different way to kind of be. Even in sitting in this chair, I start to find myself like getting a grumpy back after like 5 or 10 minutes. And then the last thing about sitting without a chair, it brings me to think about squatty potty and how a lot of people, they have bowel issues, like bowel movement problems. And I'm not saying that this is a cure-all, but I think, you know, sitting in the bottom of the squat and then, put the squatty potty, you get to kind of find some relief in your excretions. And I think that's about it that I want to say about sitting. There's so much I could probably say, but for right now, I think you should try and do a 1 minute challenge. See if you can sit in the bottom of your squat for 1 minute unbroken. And I bet if you do complete it, you'll be surprised how challenging it is and how much it feels like it's a position of work. Ideally, you would do this so often that it would be a position of rest, like you see in a lot of other Asian countries. And I'm sure there's other countries as well where they do this a lot, but my brain goes to like having been in China and seeing that as a default kind of rest position. And them having the toilet where it's just in a hole that you can go into. So number two is barefoot walking. I like barefoot walking. You know, there was the whole book, Born to Run, and they talk about how minimal footwear is really kind of how we should be living. So I also think about grounding, where they talk about you should have your feet on grass, touch grass, right? That whole saying. And there's something about, you know, receiving information from the earth and getting feedback, that when we have our rubber sole shoes on or whatever kind of shoes, it kind of disconnects us from the earth and from the grounding, picking up information. I think too that the way our shoes are designed kind of box our feet up and don't allow the feet to spread out and kind of grab the ground more. So even that, your feet are starting to become bound. Speaking of China, it's like how they used to do I hope they don't do anymore, the foot binding of people to, you know, really wrap them and to make them really small. It's like you want your feet to be able to expand out and have lots of surface area, because if that's your base, it stems all the way up through the top of your head. So a lot of problems, I think, stem from having funky feet, funky walking patterns. And those walking patterns in part are because the footwear that you're wearing is throwing your natural way of moving through space off. The only kind of sneakers I wear are the Onitsuka Serrano Tigers, and I've been wearing those since I was in high school, and I think those are the only ones that kind of work for me, having being flat-footed. So it's hard too, because if you live in an urban area like I do, you kind of don't want to be walking on the street barefoot, just because, you know, some people, they're inconsiderate and the ground is littered sometimes with like sharp objects. But I think if you could kind of go to a place, and I do this when I get to the field with my family, we'll walk in the field and play around with our feet bare. Maybe you can find a place that you know is okay. Or even, you know, if you're really in an urban environment, this is a little kooky, but, you know, you find a local park, you get some dirt, you build a little, you know, 1 foot by 1 foot or 4 foot by like 2 foot by 2 foot, small little flower bed that you can step into. And even sand, I think sand would be pretty fun to kind of, you know, just let your feet hang out in. A lot of martial arts, they'll fill the bucket up with sand and they'll do a lot of wrist training. So I think there's like a lot of ways that you can kind of get something more than just being in your Nikes and just doing it. Number three, crawling, get-ups, and other ground movement. I like this a lot. I was just thinking about how being a father, me being able to crawl on my hands and feet, go all the way down to the ground to talk to my daughter, and to have engaging conversations and relationships down on the ground is something I would never want to give up. And I'm glad that I've always practiced this, because I think it changes my relationship with my daughter. And I think if nothing else, you know, you should, if you're a father or a parent, you should consider spending more time down on the ground. And even that, thinking, how often do I get down on the ground? Not for any particular, oh, I need to pick something up. It's like, no, I'm actually going down on the ground. I'm laying on the ground. I'm letting the floor kind of be, for some people, they're so tight. Just laying and rolling on the floor is a bit of a massage. So I think you should change your level. Just changing levels is something that we can do more of. We spend too much time either in the standing high position or the seated position. And there's something about going lower that changes your perspective. Moving on all fours is a nice precursor to going into handstand. You can build up a lot of strength just walking on your hands and feet. And I think, again, rolling on the ground is something that is nice for your body. It's a massage. It's a way of, you know, when I think about it too, a lot of our time is sitting in the chair. And so our bum is making contact with the chair most of the time. And that's the only real feedback we get. You know, we might be standing, and in standing, our feet are kind of making contact. But I don't think, how often do we put our back against the wall or on the floor and roll from side to side? And I think there's something that will rewire your brain in a good way if you spend more time on the ground. So I encourage you to crawl, get up, and just other ground movement, like they say. So number four is balancing. This one I like a lot, you know, metaphorically, right? Like, how much balance are you embodying in your life? And I think there's definitely a connection between like the body and the way it expresses itself and the way that your psyche and your emotional state comes out. So if you're having trouble, maybe with balance, maybe one way you can work on your balance is by physically working on your balance. And that's easy as just walking along the curb of the sidewalk where, you know, it's like 4 or 5 inches across and you can just, like, that's easy. It's low risk and you can start to think about where you are in space. I keep using that term, but I think balance is really important. And maybe you don't even want to balance in that manner. This one is really good that I do with my students. We'll close our eyes and then we'll try and take a single leg off the floor and we'll try and maybe just like an inch or two off the floor and we'll try and hold maybe 5-10 seconds with that single foot off the floor and see how long we can do that. What happens? How much we use our eyes to find our balance instead of the little bit I know that not allowing the vestibular system to kind of help us. So I know I'm very eye dominant when I use my balance. And I'm thinking even like the balance could be something where you're on all fours, but you choose to take cross lateral. So like the left arm and the right foot off the floor, and you try and balance with only two limbs. I think there's lots of ways that we can be balancing. I think a slack line's a lot of fun. That could be a fun social way to interact with people, to work on your balance. And then a couple of years ago when I was in my first professional dance job, they had a tightrope, and the tightrope was maybe 3 feet off the ground, and I fell in love with that. So eventually I intend on buying a small tightrope to work on and be Philippe Petit one day and go across two of the buildings. The next one is number 5, jumping and landing. So yeah, jumping and landing I think is really critical. My brain goes right to like the elderly and how when they are walking and sometimes they'll clip their foot, maybe on a flight of stairs, on a step, and they'll fall and they'll, you know, break a bone, break a hip, break a shoulder, break the humerus or something. It's like a lot of these injuries could be prevented if they worked on their landing and their jumping capacity. And just being able to be reactive enough to catch yourself. You know, sometimes you clip your foot, and because we're younger, we are able to then set the foot in really quick and support ourselves through the fall, so we don't fall on our face or whatever. So I think of it just from a preventative aspect that jumping is really important and landing is really important. I think too, like leaving the earth, there's something we should be doing every day, leaving the earth. My daughter just started jumping a couple days ago, and I think that's like, holy smokes, like when you think about that, like just from human development, that concept is a big leap, right? It's a big jump into like, okay, for a moment I left the earth and now I'm back. And you know, we could think about more what that means, but and even the metaphor or the like, that idea of landing, it's like, are your thoughts landing where you want them to land? Or, and this is me, you know, I think so lofty all the time that I need to practice landing more. So I like that idea. Number 6, carrying something heavier than an iPhone. Carrying's cool. I like very simple or like heavy sandbag carry. So, or even something simple like a slam ball. And that's something that's like maybe 5-10 pounds. You pick it up, you can walk it. Even just grabbing two dumbbells that are like 20 pounds each and walking 50 feet and then 50 feet back is a workout in itself. And, you know, like strongman suitcase carries, like all that stuff is really good. And I'm thinking, you know, if you're a beginner, then just carrying anything for a long distance, for half a block or around your block once or twice, and then, you know, reversing the direction. Because it's true. It's like, well, I don't know. I carry all the time. So I think I'm always in that world. I'm trying to think, like, I guess people don't really carry stuff anymore. When I see people wearing backpacks and the backpack isn't properly attached to their body, you know, it's this huge backpack. It's kind of like draping over and like sinking down towards their bum. And all that weight is pulling them backwards. So then they round the shoulders forward and they kind of like have to walk like this. I'm like, man, that's not a good way to carry. It's throwing your body all out of whack. So when I wear my backpack, I'll tighten, I'll clip across the chest and I'll tighten the two shoulders down so that it's like hugging my body. And then it's a lot easier to carry weight that way. But I think even carrying weight over the head, you know, you trying it, carrying 20 pounds over the head for like 50 feet and then 50 feet back, you know, do a couple sets of those and you'll be like, wow, my shoulders feel really on and activated. And I like the idea of just general heavy carries. If you don't have a big budget and you need to get something that can help you work out, you could buy a simple sandbag and fill it up with sand or lead shot. And that is like endless. You know, you could pick it off the ground and bring it to the shoulder. You could toss it over the shoulder and do repetitions of that. You can carry it and just walk. You know, 100 feet, and that simple kind of carries that will get your heart rate up, and it's cardio, but it's not, you know, too intense. And in that world too, sled drags. If you ever have a sled or something that you can drag, they don't put this in here, but I think dragging stuff is really good for you too. If you work towards whatever weight properly. And then number seven, hanging and climbing. That's like, you know, something that I think would help our world big time. Spending more time arms above head and just hanging will let your shoulder find a place of relief. Because when you even think about it, a lot of our time, the arm is hanging down. So the shoulder, though, has so much range of motion. There, it can go all the way back. It can go across. So we give up a little bit of stability that we have in the hip socket because it sits a little bit tighter in there in the ball and socket. But the shoulder is a little bit more free. So we have more range of motion and maybe a little less strength, like in the joint structure itself. But the shoulder can be up here. And why don't we try and load the shoulder in this position just by hanging? And I encourage a lot of my students to do, you know, 10-second hangs for the first, you know, couple weeks. Try and get 6 10-second hangs and notice how your shoulders feel better. Like, there's just something about gravity and like your body that will find its own way. It'll work, you know. And let's say you don't have the shoulder range of motion, then maybe you do feet on the floor, maybe either the bar is low enough or you have a box or something to bridge the gap between you and the bar, and you support most of your weight through your feet, but you still work on building up range of motion in the shoulder above head. And then you work towards, you know, reducing how much support you're giving through the feet. Hanging is so important. And then climbing, you know, that's the other component. Yeah, rock climbing is one of those things that will get you super, super strong. And I think of how it's like a form of chess. It's like physical chess for some people. I don't do too much of it, but the other one that comes in that world is brachiating. So swinging, you know, and I think of like the gymnastics rings that you might find at Venice. And even that, just having one arm carry the whole load of the body for a moment until you catch to the next ring is, you know, like, it's so healthy for your shoulders. So I think just loading the shoulders in different positions. And that's the same thing where, like, if you were to do a heavy carry, like you're holding 2 50-pound dumbbells in each hand, that's loading the shoulder in a certain way that we don't do enough of. So I think a lot. And then also, because we're typing all the time, our shoulder starts to roll forward and we get a little bit of tightness in the pec. So loading the shoulder up in this way gives it a moment to stretch. So that's like another real positive of hanging and climbing. Number 8 is throwing and catching. I think this is great, you know, makes sense. I probably could do more throwing. I mean, I'll toss stuff. So, I mean, that's the verb I think of for throwing and catching. Like light balls and maybe frisbees. But it makes sense, right? Like, you're manipulating object and you're trying to send it further out. Yeah, I can't really think too much about that. I mean, there's something also nice about it pairs you up with someone usually, because when you throw, there's someone else who's hopefully catching, unless you're like, you know, doing it by yourself. Or you're playing handball. Maybe you play handball and it's just going back and forth between the wall. But I think there's that whole social aspect that comes to mind when I think of throwing and catching. I feel like there's something else I should be picking up on for throwing and catching. I guess that, you know, it could be something light, like a tennis ball or a frisbee. But then there's something nice about throwing something that's maybe a light sand slam ball or a light sand, what's the word for it? Like a sandbag, but not a sandbag, but something that's light and tossing that back and forth for a few feet. There's this one exercise I'll do with my students where we are shoulder to shoulder, but maybe 10 feet apart from each other. So we're facing side by side. And we'll rotate, throw across, and they'll catch it. They'll spiral away, and then they'll spiral back and throw it to me. And then we'll kind of just loop that back and forth. And there's something about throwing with that spiraling motion that's super healthy for our bodies, this idea of spiraling. You know, because if we're doing all of this sagittal movement forwards and backwards, how much are we doing where we're rotating? And I think it's traverse plane. transverse. Traverse is to move. Transverse is the transverse, where we spiral around. And then how much of your time are you actually moving? I think it's laterally. It's there's two different words. It's like horizontal or laterally. Like how much of your time are you bending like this and moving from side to side? So number nine, swimming. Yeah, swimming's like critical. I think everyone should be swimming. I remember reading that swimming is probably one of the highest per hour calorie movements that you can do. And it beats out so many other things. Like, so if you're one who's about calories and getting energy out, swimming is one of those things that like will burn the most, supposedly burn the most calories per hour. I like swimming too because it's low impact. So if you're heavier and you're trying to lose weight, you know, you could start off going in the water and you could get a really like an hour long workout and you're not pounding on your joints, on your knees, or maybe you have different issues with your hips or your spine and you can't be running or you can't be, you know, sitting on a bike. Like swimming is awesome because you could get a really good cardio workout in that. I also just like those swimming kind of, what do you call it? The aqua fitness that the older ladies will do at the gym. I think, you know, just kind of moving your arms underneath the water and spiraling and kicking and is a great way to kind of just open up your body. Swimming too, and it's like, yeah, you never know. You might fall into water, so you should know how to swim. So I think like that everyone should be encouraged to swim in. Yeah, swimming's great. And just that you could swim in so many different ways. There's all these different strokes. I remember maybe two or three summers ago, I started to finally get the wave motion for the butterfly. For most of my life, I could never figure out how to coordinate the circling of the arms and shoulders with that kind of wave motion. And just within the past like year or two, like I said, I started to really understand, oh, like, the best way to do that and to get my body to move underwater all the way through from my toes, my ankles, my knees, my pelvis, my spine, and through the top of my head. So swimming is really good. And number 10 is moving through nature. Yeah, I mean, they say that more and more people are getting pushed into these urban areas. And how much nature is there? I mean, if you're in a really good city, maybe they have some nice parks, but you know, I think more and more we're not even, and what is nature, right? Like I grew up in the Bronx. So my understanding of nature is like, wow, there's lots of trees and I might see some squirrels. And like where we live now, there's a couple hawks and I'm blown away. I'm like, oh, I see two hawks out in the sky, or I might see a deer. There's a couple of deer and I'm like super impressed that like I could be walking on the little trail and see a deer just like jumping around, running around. But I think, yeah, just the idea of moving in nature makes sense, right? Like there's that whole grounding your feet. There's just seeing where we are, like, you know, seeing the vegetation, seeing the animal life. No, like, cause in the woods or whatever, there's this whole other information network that's going on. And I thought about this, that if the trees are going up into the sky, I'm pretty sure the roots go equally down into the ground. I know I need to do more research, but I just had that thought of like right below my feet is this whole network of roots that are like going deep underground and almost like the same way the branches are almost touching between two trees, the root systems are almost touching between. And maybe they're intertwining and stuff. I need to do more research. I grew up in the Bronx, right? So give me some slack. But I think even that idea is, and everything that we experience is from nature, right? There's nothing outside of nature. And I was just listening to The Machine Lies, and he was recently on Chalk Body Outline's stream, and he goes through a lot of ideas. And one of the ideas that he goes through is about that nature creates technology. So any technology that we experience is from nature. You know, it's like, he says second order nature. it's nature making technology, but it's still natural. So anyway, the idea of like just being out in nature, there's this whole information network that you could tap into that probably could inspire you and help you problem solve that we're missing. We're getting caught again, like in this digital world that all we see are the screens. And even just the idea of that, like the screen is maybe half a foot away from your face or whatever. And you're just being bombarded with the LEDs, the lights from your screen or from your phone. And your vision starts to get shorter. So you can't even see further anymore. They say you should every 20 minutes, hop off the device, look 20 feet away so that you can keep your eyes nice and strong. And so like information network, like I bet, you know, next time you have something that you're kind of stuck on, you know, an idea you're stuck on or a relationship that you're thinking about and trying to work through, maybe go into nature and just walk and just move through the woods or whatever area it is. And maybe you'll notice like there's something that just kind of resets us. I should do more research on like the Schumann resonance and this idea that the earth is vibrating and that we are on the earth. So in some way, we're constantly getting this feedback. Of course, right? But I don't know, I guess about moving in nature, that makes a lot of sense. And I should be doing more of it. I'm happy though, because where we live, I'm actually right near a creek. So that's really cool. So I think that's, let me just get a little thing. So that kind of closes out the 10 human movements. And I'm sure there's way more. That was just the first couple that I was running this class the other day and I mentioned this and they asked me like, oh, what are the movements? And I was like, oh shoot. I only remember like two or three of them, like the sitting, going into the bottom of the squat, super important. Hanging or brachiating, super important. We should be doing more hanging in general. And I think even into our older years, like all these movements should be the staple of what we do. Like you don't even have to work out. You just need to be like, did I do any of these movements today? And if you didn't, try and do some of them or do all of them and expand your expression in those movements and in those poses, whatever it is. So I like that. And this is going to bring me, this stream is a little bit choppy, but my goal is to talk about this idea that I have that we are losing a lot of these movements. You know, I know if I were to ask someone on the train, hey, can you go into the bottom of a squat? A lot of them wouldn't be able to do it. And a lot of them, if they could do it, they would need something for support to assist them going into the bottom. So, and I know hanging, oh my dear, like hanging is probably even worse than the sitting in the bottom of the squat. The number of people that can hang and hold their body weight, even for 10 seconds, I bet is concerning. And then it goes back to like what I was saying, like if you can't even do a pull-up, then you don't even think about doing a pull-up. And what does that do to your brain? You stop thinking about certain ways of expressing yourself. So you don't express yourself in certain ways. So your thoughts and your experiences get smaller and you do less in the 3D world. So then you're getting less feedback. And I think that kind of tightens our tunnel and pigeonholes us a little bit more into like whatever we can do. There's that inner outer expressivity that we should all be working on. And I think that even though these are the movements that we can notice are going extinct, I have a suspicion that we have movements that we used to be able to do and have actually gone extinct. And that's a part of the idea that I'm kind of trying to flesh out, that there's more to what our physical capacity, our physical bodies can do. And I think we can still unlock those or reconnect with those ways of expressing, but we need to do a lot of work. All right, so now going on to the third component, ARG mentioned. So while I mention that, I want to go to share this tab, and then that's muted. So I'll play this for a little bit, and then maybe I'll jump around to a couple other things. But this is a dance company, Palabolas. I think it's modern and postmodern dance company, and they're really cool. Let me pop this like this, and then okay, that's kind of cool. Yeah. So I'm going to mention what an ARG is, and I should probably hide that. Okay, cool. So an ARG is an alternate reality game. And let me pull it up so I can. I was doing research on this, but I should have been more prepared. But anyway, is an interactive networked narrative that uses the real world as a platform and employs transmedia storytelling to deliver a story that may be influenced by players or ideas. And transmedia storytelling is also known as transmedia narrative or multi-platform storytelling, is a technique of telling a single story or story experience across multiple platforms and formats using current digital technologies. I don't want that one. I don't want that one. Share this one. Whoops. Yeah, sorry. So that is what an alternate reality game is. And I think my next kind of conversation that I'm going to put up here is going to be talking about alternate reality games in greater detail and how we could. My goal is to create an alternate reality game and to play and to use physical, you know, what you would call physical fitness as one of the components to this game. I think as a way to encourage and excite people into being back in their bodies. And it's up to me, you know, like if I really want people to be back in their bodies and to know the beauty and the grace of their bodies, I should be creative and engaging and find ways to get people off their devices for a moment and back into their bodies. And this dance company is really out there. They're super cool. It's Palabolas. I'll pull up the thing in a second, but I think about even like this kind of partner work. There's like play, and there's a play that, you know, every time you improvise with someone, you might have some ideas or prompts that you're given, but it's just really healthy for your brain. And I think I want this ARG to be something that's healthy for my brain and for other people's brains, and not just like, I have to do all this working out so I could lose weight, or I have to do all this working out so I can be healthy for my whole life. I think like the real goal would be like, I do this movement and these exercises because I enjoy them. And I think like a way to make people enjoy movement could also be just by having it be fun, right? And we forget time, and we forget a lot of things when things are fun. So maybe in the next day or two, I'll be able to really present a coherent idea about an alternate reality game. Yeah, these guys are super cool. So Palabolas, boom, they're super cool. Let me go back to StreamYard and then stop sharing that one. All right, cool. So I think I hit on all the points. Of course, right, there's like not too many. I did my day 66. So I encourage you to get off your keister and do something, you know, even if it's stretching for like 5 minutes while you're watching your show and eating your ice cream, that's okay. The 10 human movements going extinct. I don't think they're going extinct. I think we're losing a lot of them. And maybe you can just keep those 10 ideas in your mind and just use them as movement prompts, you know, like write them on like a whiteboard of sorts. And then throughout the day, when you go by, you roll a dice and like, oh, it hit two. And what's number two? It's walking barefoot or whatever it was. And then you get pulled into that for like 30 seconds. That's a whole idea I had as well. But don't let your movements go extinct. and be in your body more. And then the ARG, yeah, I already said that, so I hope to get that out sooner than later. And now, let's see, should I finish off with just a couple handstand push-ups?
On screen.
Right. If this whole thing is like about movement, I can't just be sitting on my ass the whole time, right? I have to, in real time, I have to do something like a push-up. Oh, wait, this is perfect because the door's right there, so I don't even have to move all that stuff. Perfect. And then let me move this. Just for five, just for five.
Come on, man. You want to go by? You can go by. All right, you can go by.
This amateur hour here. All right.
All right,
just for five. All right, seriously. Hell yeah. Hell yeah. Come on now, right? You got to get energized. Like, even if you're a content creator, shout out to Provo Kid. Shout out to Ben. These two guys, appreciate their work so far. If you're a content creator, get off your bum for a little bit, move around a little bit. I think I'm trying to speak to those people as well. Yeah, so better today, better tomorrow. And